Welcome to Imperial College London and this special lecture from the Grantham Institute and the Energy Futures Lab. This is the sixth time that an audience at Imperial has heard a report from the International Energy Agency about the outlook for world energy. Back in 2010, the UK was under the first year of the Conservative Lib Dem coalition government, and Prime Minister David Cameron had pledged to make this, in quotes, the greenest government ever. At the same time, IEA chief economist Dr. Fatih Birol presented a scenario that tried to anticipate the future actions that would be needed by governments to limit climate change to 2 degrees centigrade and tackle growing energy insecurity. So the World Energy Outlook 2010 put the spotlight on impacts for oil markets, the critical role for China in the global energy landscape, the costs and benefits of increasing renewable energy, and the lack of access to electricity in sub-Saharan Africa and Southern Asia. Now, in 2016, after COP21, the Paris Agreement is signed and delivered thanks to the tireless work of the government negotiators and the UNFCCC. And I should tell you, the president of the UNFCCC, Christiana Figueres, will be speaking here at Imperial College at Grantham Institute annual lecture on the 11th of April. So if you haven't signed up for that, check our website out. You'll be very welcome to come to that. So clearly, following COP21, the onus is on governments of the world to act on the promises that they made in their INDCs to reduce the emissions that are now necessary. There's still a big focus on developing countries, particularly China, to digress their energy demand from their economic growth, and work at the Grantham Institute by our senior policy fellow Neil Hurst with China's Energy Research Institute is supporting the ambition of the authorities there. The Grantham Institute has published a new briefing paper today, and you have a copy of it, copies around, about how the cost of capital is a critical factor in encouraging the private sector to invest in renewable and low carbon technologies. It's written by Grantham affiliate Charlie Donovan, also at the Business School at Imperial College, so please do take that away from you. It's a very interesting read. Elsewhere in the UK today, the Carbon Brief announced that our carbon emissions fell by 4.3% in 2015, the largest since the miners' strike in 1984, thanks to further reduction in the amount of coal that we burn. So clearly, it's progress that's being made. Our speaker today, Kamel Ben Naceur, joins us with more than 30 years of experience in the energy and industry sectors around the world. As IEA Director for Sustainability Technology and Outlooks, he oversees two highly regarded publications, the World Energy Outlook, here today, and the Energy Technology Perspectives. This puts him in the unique position to marry knowledge about technical solutions for carbon emissions, climate change, international development, and economic growth with an understanding of the energy policy landscape and what it will take to turn pledges into action. Mr. Ben Naceur's report states, and I quote from it, "There are unmistakable signs that the much-needed global energy transition is underway, but not yet at a pace that leads to a lasting reversal of the trend of rising CO2 emissions." So I look forward to hearing his take on the opportunities ahead for governments, businesses, and energy sector in the UK, and perhaps some suggestions for the challenges he thinks those of us in academia should focus on as well. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Kamel Ben Naceur.
Thank you very much for the very kind introduction. It's a double honor for me to be here today. The first one is being at the Grantham Institute. And the second one is following on the tradition that has been set by Fatih Birol to present every year the World Energy Outlook at the Grantham Institute. Dr. Birol has moved up. He's now the executive director for the IEA. And so one of the most difficult decisions that in his life that he had to do was to pass the direction of the World Energy Outlook to someone. So he asked me to do that. So I told him, Fatih, you will always be the father of the bride. So let's make this clear that it's your personal baby, and you will always be associated with that. So I'm just reporting on his behalf. So it's a great pleasure to be here. If for people who know the energy sector, I think 2015 has been one of the most exciting years in the history for many events. I would say that for me personally, there were two very important events. One was the New York meeting, where Sustainable Development Goal number 7 was adopted, which was setting energy access as being one of the priorities. And the second one was on the Paris Declaration. So these, from that standpoint, I think 2015 will remain in history in terms of the energy sector. But there are many, many other things that I will be speaking about that also make that year absolutely unique in terms of what it does. So the first one that we all see is the lower prices for fossil fuels. I was in the US last week and paying gasoline prices at $1.40 per gallon. I don't think that we have seen over anything like this over the last decade. But there have also been very severe implications. The first one is that, and this is the first time in almost 30 years, that we would see 2 years in a row investment in the upstream sector going down. We look at the history over the last two or three decades, and what we see is whenever we had a downturn in the oil and gas sector, we generally had a V-shaped type downturns. That means that the activity goes down very drastically over 1 year, but then it picks up the following year. This time, we would see 2 years in a row of downturn. And this now looks more like a U-shape rather than a V-shape. So this has very profound implications. I mean, for those of you who have been to the North Sea, we see dramatic implications in terms of employment. 60,000 people or more have lost their jobs in the North Sea. You go to the US, 300,000 people have lost jobs in the US in the upstream sector, 300,000. Well, if it weren't for the 4.9% unemployment rate in the US, I mean, it would have been very dramatic. But the U.S. market, labor market, has this capacity of absorbing those skilled people. The second thing is that the coal prices have also hit a low in the last 15 years. So we will look at the, in terms of the signs. And this first graph, which was as of this week, the US rig count, we look at the evolution over the last four and a half decades, and it shows that currently as of February 2016, we have hit the lowest level of rig count in more than four decades. The only time where it went so much down was 1999. That was just after the Asian crisis, but throughout the period, even in the mid 1980s, for those of you who were in the oil and gas sector, we didn't have a rig count in US that has been as low. The second one is we look at the investment, the upstream investment in the oil and gas sector. What we see there is in billion dollars, the levels of investment in the upstream sector. And if we look over the last 15 years, pretty much except for 1 year, which was 2008 to 2009, they have been increasing. And what we see is that we see what I was telling you about is 2 years in a row of investment going down. So we are now back in 2016. At a level that would be comparable to where we were in 2008, 2009. So what does it mean? For the oil and gas sector, it's extremely important because the age pyramid that we have in the oil and gas sector is very peculiar. We have an age pyramid that has two humps. We have the first hump are people that are 50 years and above. And the second hump are people that are in their 30s, early 30s. So, and in between, we have a very flat curve. What does the recent downturn in the upstream sector mean? That a lot of those people that are 50 and above would be going out of the oil and gas sector, and they would not, many of them would not go back if the situation improves. So this puts a risk in terms of competency of project managers, in terms of large project management. So that is one risk that should not be underestimated in terms of implication of the current downturn. You look at the 24% reduction in 2015, and then 17% at least for 2016. So this compounded gets you into almost a 45% decline in the activity in the upstream sector. So that is the, if you look at the, in where that happens, this is per country where that has happened. So obviously North America has been impacted. But what you see is that we have also signs of other places that are going down at a much lower level. So even Middle East, that has been investing quite significantly, is seeing some signs of weaknesses. We look at one of the reasons for the oil, current oil price. We look, this is coming from the IEA oil market report. This is a February one. We see in yellow the demand line, and the green is the supply line. So while between 2009 and 2014, we had pretty much the two lines at the same level, what we saw in 2014 is quite a significant departure of those two lines. And the yellow line became significantly lower than the green line. So in the blue bars that you have there, the blue bars represents the amount of oil that is being stored. So what you see is that positive storage throughout this period from 2014 going forward, we have the projections for 2016, and we are in positive storage mode. Today, it's extremely difficult to find oil storage capacity. So this is definitely a factor for decreasing the oil prices. We see by the end of 2016, those two curves converging, but we need to look beyond that. And earlier this week, the IEA produced what we call the midterm oil market report, which looks at the next 5 years. The next 5 years, we see our two lines, one for oil demand and one for oil supply, and really where the two curves will meet will be 2017. And then there will be a departure. The stock will start depleting in 2017. So pretty much 2016 would be a year where we would have more and more oil that would have to find storage space. The average rate would be between 1 and 1.5 million barrels per day that needs to find a place to be stored. You look at land storage, or you look at the floating storage, both of them are pretty much full in many places. So that is the outlook, and this is what we announced this week, which shows that by end of 2017, we should start seeing some relief in this market. We looked at some of the fundamentals of the position of the OPEC countries, and this is showing the additional demand in oil that has been forecasted between now and 2040. Essentially, what we are forecasting is that the oil demand will increase by about 14 million barrels per day. So this is the extra demand that would have to be filled. Obviously, you have the decline from existing fields, and then you have the new capacity that is being that will have to be put. So what we're showing here is the sources. This is based on earlier oil prices. So this is the net decline from other producers. And then the United States will be contributing thanks to the tight oil from shales through this period. And this would tend to go down with time. The second part that would be also contributing to about 3 or 4 million barrels per day is Canada with the heavier oil. Brazil, with the pre-salt, would have the capacity to add another 4 million barrels per day. But most of the additional production would then, after 2020, would have to come from the Middle East. So these are the sources. So what happens now is that pretty much the light tight oil is, with the prices that we are seeing today at $30 per barrel, has become non-economical. The Canada is also a big question mark. Brazil, despite the very significant improvements in technology, and I used to work in Brazil, the first deep water pre-salt well in Brazil cost $300 million, $300 million for a single well. Now they have gone, thanks to technology, to about $60 million per well. So a factor of five in terms of improvement of cost. But still, at $30 per barrel, it makes those projects not economical. So this would put more and more reliance on the Middle East. In terms of coal, and this is our medium-term coal market report that was published in January, what we see is these are the prices per ton, and this is where we are today, and this would be the lowest price over the last decade in terms of coal prices. And going forward, we see that prices will remain at about the same level or even lower than what they are today. So from in terms of fossil fuels, that we look at places like US in terms of coal only 6 years ago, 6-7 years ago, represented 50% of the power generation. It has been going down, and 2010 45%, but now we are at 33% of coal in the US. So this would be the lowest in history in terms of coal generation. And this is thanks to two things. One is the natural gas, and second thing, with beginning of competition from the renewable, which we see at the bottom. So that's the first point from the fossil fuels. The second point is that signals have turned green. I think you mentioned the carbon report, 2015, about the emissions. So 2014, emissions didn't rise. 2015, they even went down, despite an economic growth of about 3 to 3.5% on a worldwide level. So we're starting to see some decoupling. The third one is that the fossil fuel subsidy reform that we have all been advocating, which was a distortion in the economical mechanism, has started to be put in place. The latest example, even if it's not really relevant, is Venezuela increasing by several folds the gasoline prices, but with more impact, Saudi Arabia increasing significantly their gasoline prices was a very, very strong signal that this fossil fuel subsidy reform is now being enabled all over the world. And also, the other miracle that happened is, and if I was standing here last year, betting that 187 countries will submit their NDCs or INDCs. The chances in any betting house would not have been very high. So, I think a miracle happened thanks to UNFCCC, to the French presidency, but also the coalition of the willing. We see also from the renewable that the 2014 has seen the highest level in terms of capacity of additional capacity in renewable, 130 gigawatt of renewable capacity has been put in the system, and this would be the highest number. This is where we were in 2014. 2015 would be about the same level, slightly higher. Our projection is, with the current policies, is that we would be still at the 120, slightly lower. But there is a potential for going even further to about 160 gigawatts. Where is that going to come from? Hydro, which was the biggest single component in 2013, will start going down, and this is being replaced by onshore wind and more solar PV. And the prices that we have seen from recent auctions of anywhere from 6 cents the kilowatt hour, and even the latest number we had in Morocco from wind were about 3 cents per kilowatt hour. So quite a remarkable decline in the prices. This is a slide that has been shown by Secretary Moniz on the progress that has been made between the Copenhagen COP and the Paris COP in terms of costs of technologies. This is using 100 as a basis for 2008 to 2014. What we see is that the land-based wind has declined by 40%. The distributed PV and utility scale PV photovoltaic have decreased by almost 60%. Battery cost, 70%, and LEDs have decreased by 90%. So quite a remarkable drop in terms of cost that have happened over a very short period of time. We used to say that in the energy systems, the typical cycle for energy was between concept to deployment was in the order of 25 to 30 years. Now we are getting to much, much more rapid curves in terms of technology cost improvement that we have seen. So these are the signs that we are starting to see. We had a very happy marriage between GDP and energy demand over the last 15 years. Very happy. They were following each other very nicely. The good thing is that we are going to see a happy divorce. This is China, and these are the projections of GDP in China going forward to 2040. And the remarkable thing is that the divorce is happening between the energy demand. So that means that the economy is becoming much more, in terms of energy intensity, much better in terms of energy intensity for a number of reasons. One is the transformation of the industry, say, of the economy, from being mostly industry driven to be more services one. And second thing is that more and more energy efficiency is being adopted. So what we see is that we have about a threefold increase in GDP, while the increase of energy demand will be only 30%. So quite a remarkable trajectory for China in terms of energy. If we look at their fuel mix in China, where we have seen the return of King Coal from 2000 to 2015. We see in 2015 the first sign of a drop in coal demand, and then it's going to plateau or even go lower. Oil will continue to rise and then plateau. Gas is really, from the fossil fuel, the one that is going to be increasing. And then, obviously, the other two big stories are renewables and nuclear in China. So we see, in 2040, a very different fuel mix between coal and the rest of the energy, primary energy mix. It was interesting, the first time I saw this type of curve in China was they were not showing that in million tons of oil equivalent, they were showing it in million tons of coal equivalent, because for them everything was coal driven. So these are the some of the transformation that we have started to see in China economy. If we look now at the worldwide projections, this is on our what we call the new policy scenario. What we see is that China has been increasing, the rest of the world have been increasing, OECD has plateaued and gone down. OECD will be, despite the economic growth of about 2%, will be at the same level. China, as we have seen, will increase by about 30%, and the rest of the world will continue to increase. So we will start to see other regions of the world that are taking much bigger share. So that's why the World Energy Outlook of 2015 focuses on two areas, two regions. One is India, and the other one was Southeast Asia, because these would be some of the engines of growth going forward. If we look at the where the energy demand will be increasing, changing between 2014 and 2040, European Union, US, and Japan will be going down in terms of primary energy demand. We will have growth in those four areas. Africa, definitely, as today we have 600 million people that don't have access to electricity in sub-Sahara Africa. And then China and India. India will be having the largest increase in terms of primary energy demand. So these are some of the new trends that we are starting to see, thanks to two things. One is that China transforming their energy systems, and the second thing, the growth of India is going to be to continue. We have the plans in India, or the ambition to have this made in India, which has been promoted by Prime Minister Modi, which would go from services to more industry basis, which is interesting because in most other countries we go the other way around. But India is taking a different route. What we are assuming is that in terms of cost of technologies going forward, solar PV, we're seeing about in the next 25 years a 50% decrease. On onshore wind, another 20 to 25%. On lighting, another 50%. And then industrial heat production, about 20%. The only one that could be going up to down are the oil and gas, essentially because we will be going to oil and gas assets that would be more complex from both a surface standpoint or a subsurface standpoint. If I mentioned earlier the prices of developing oil and gas in Brazil, these are the deep water ones which would be more and more developed during this period. We have also the tight oil in other places that will be. So this is our outlook in terms of energy cost. We also looked at what the lower oil prices mean for the global energy systems? Can we sustain a couple of decades lower oil prices? Can the world energy systems be able to have low oil prices? So that was one of the scenarios that we have looked at in the World Energy Outlook. One of the areas that we have looked at is the U.S. and the light tight oil in the U.S. or the oil shales. So this shows, as a function of the price per barrel, what would be the change of U.S. production in the next 5 years as a function of these oil prices. What we have seen in 2015 was a drop in cost in the oil, production of shale oil in the U.S. Where did that come from? It came partly from efficiency and technology, but it also came mostly from the service sector significantly reducing their prices in order to survive with this very big drop in activity. So for us, we consider that decrease in prices that happened in 2015 may not be sustained for the year. But so we did the modeling on how much oil would the U.S. produce as a function of the oil prices. And what we see is that basically we need to have a price between $60 and $70 per barrel to justify the investment that would make the production in the U.S. at the today's level. So there would be no change in production in 2020. Doesn't mean that it's not going to, there will be no activity. Obviously, have to replace those production from oil shales. We all know that the oil shales, when you start producing these wells, they produce almost 80%, they drop by 80% their production in their first year. So what we show is that if we are at $40 per barrel, the U.S. production will go down by 3 million barrels per day by 2020. If we are at $80 to $100 per barrel, we will be at an additional 1 million barrels per day. So there is a whole range of outcomes that would depend on the oil prices going forward. So we looked at it also in terms of implication on the geopolitical systems. What we're saying is that we can sustain, from a production standpoint, the lower oil prices for the 2020s to 2030 at the $50. The oil importers would certainly benefit in terms of economy and additional purchasing power. The third one is that the risk is that within a decade or so, or a couple of decades, we would be going down in terms of dependency of oil supply to where we were in the 70s. So there is a risk of completely shifting the supply system around the world. The other thing is that by shifting it to the OPEC countries, you become much more dependent on geopolitical issues that, unfortunately, we have many of them today in that particular area of the world, which would mean that investment will fall short. Just to give you an example, if there is something happening in Libya in terms of that would disrupt the production system, basically you could have 800,000 barrels per day disappearing from the supply side. The other implications of the lower oil prices would be in terms of support for energy efficiency and clean energy investment. This would reduce the appetite from policymakers to put incentives for those cleaner energy and energy efficiency. And then the other ones is that the reduction in revenues of the oil producers could have very strong geopolitical impact. We have seen the impact in places like Venezuela, where the situation has really gone extremely difficult for the local population. In terms of the major changes going forward from the energy side between 2014 and 2040, in terms of coal, the demand from coal will be going down from the EU and from the US, which we see there, but this would be replaced by additional demand from India and then Southeast Asia and to some lesser extent by Africa. In terms of oil, the biggest demand growth will be coming from India, which will be requiring almost 6 million barrels per day in additional oil demand, followed by China. And this would be balancing a decline in demand from US and EU and Japan. And then finally, in solar PV, the biggest growth will be coming from China, followed by India and then the OECD economies. So this is what we see in terms of the changes in the main fuels. In terms of electricity generation, today we have pretty much very high dependency on coal. Renewable is number two, followed by gas, and then the fourth one is nuclear, and the fifth one is oil. We have some countries that are still using oil for power generation, which is a waste. What do we see in 2040? In 2040, oil will be declining in terms of use for power generation. In terms of nuclear, we will see an increase by about 60%, mostly driven by places like Asia, China, and other countries in the area. But also next year, we will see the first plant in the UAE, which was built with the Koreans. In gas, we see an increase by about 70 to 80% in terms of generation. Coal will still increase in terms of generation, but certainly will be significantly cleaner because we are going more and more to ultra-supercritical power plants. And then the great news is that renewable will become number one in terms of generation for the electricity, with hydro increases, but the biggest increase will be coming from wind, and then after hydro, it will be solar. So this would be a completely new generation mix going forward compared to what we have today. Efficiency, energy efficiency, which is quite important. Today, or 2005, only 14% of the sectors in different countries were between industry, buildings, and transport were covered by energy efficiency policies. We have seen significant improvement in 2014, almost doubling that number. And then what we see is that 2040, we will have much more coverage by energy efficiency, almost hitting the 40%. So we are seeing this progress in energy efficiency policies. So looking forward in terms of growth and primary energy demand and emissions, we had what we called earlier the marriage, the happy marriage. But what we see is that going forward, we will have this divorce with GDP continuing to grow, hopefully, and then energy demand increasing at a much lower rate, but then energy-related CO2 emissions decoupling and almost remaining flat. This is the new policy, and it's pretty much what the countries have announced in their NDC. So what we see is that we don't see a decline in the emissions that we would like to see as per the Paris statement. In terms of fuel mix, we have our new policy scenario. Oil under the current policy will still continue to increase, and then gas will increase at a larger rate. If we go to a 2-degree scenario, oil will peak by 2020, and gas continue to increase, and then will be at a flight level. This is the simulation that would take us to the 2-degree scenario. So we see quite a significant difference in terms of outcome between the new policy and the 450 or the 2-degree scenario. Because of time, I'm going to switch with that, but this is the key decarbonization graph. This would be if we don't change our system today, this would be, we'll be in on a 6-degree trend in terms of emissions. This is in gigaton of CO2. We'll go from 35 gigatons to about 55 gigatons of CO2. If we want to be on a 2-degree, we need to go by 2050. This is coming from our energy technology perspectives, to about 15 gigatons. The difference between those two, which is 20 gigatons, would be coming from decarbonization wedges. And the biggest one is the efficiency, 38%, followed by renewable, 30%, and then the carbon capture and storage, 13%. So between these three, we will have almost 80% of the decarbonization. The other components being fuel switching and the nuclear will be another 18%. So these are the decarbonization wedges that we would need to reach the two-degree scenario. So in order to, when we were working ahead of the COP, the IEA was extremely involved in terms of doing simulations for the governments and the UNFCCC. We issued in June a special report on energy and climate change. Energy representing 2/3 of the emissions needs also to be a significant part of the solution. So what we recommended were 4 actions. And the first one was on trying to get to a peak in emissions. So that was the first message. And we will show you how we can get there. Second thing is the use the Paris Agreement to set the ambitions and also set the short-term actions. Third one is on innovation, and the fourth one is on energy security and resilience of the energy system. So these were the 4 main messages. On the 5 actions that we were recommending, what we were saying is that if we look at the blue line, this is by taking together all the INDCs from the countries, we still are on a trajectory that is increasing in terms of emissions. We develop what we call the bridge scenario. The bridge scenario allows you to peak the emissions before 2020 and start declining. This without impacting economic growth, this without impacting energy access, and third thing, this using today's technology. So we can go from this trajectory that the countries have come up with to this one, which would be finally showing a decline in emissions. So how do we get from blue to green? 5 sets of measures. The first one is energy efficiency. Energy efficiency representing half of the 5 gigatons that we have there that we need to cut. A second one is by shutting down inefficient coal-fired power plants. The third one is by investing more in renewable compared to the current trajectory. Then from the upstream sector, reducing the methane emissions from the oil and gas sector. And finally, by reducing the fossil fuel subsidy reform. So with these 5 measures, you can go to this bridge scenario and finally see this decoupling, complete decoupling. So these are the five measures. Obviously, if you go from one area, region in the world to another one, you would have different sets of measures. So if I go, for instance, in the US, efficiency would be one, coal plants, and then renewable, and they represent about 90% of the efforts. You don't have fossil fuel subsidies in the US. If you go to the Middle East, half of it will be from fossil fuel subsidies. Going to Europe, about 65 to 70% will come from energy efficiency. So every region will have a different ways to further the INDC and go to this bridge scenario. So that is the what we did. So COP21 was a great success, and again, congratulations to all those involved. The long-term mitigation goal was well below 2 degrees with efforts to limit to 1.5. And then the second point was aim to reach a peaking of emissions. So we saw that we could do it with a scenario like the bridge scenario. And then also the achieve a balance between emissions and removals by sink in the second half of this century. So net zero emissions, but although these words were not used. And then the need for to communicate this strategy. So in terms of budget, carbon budget, when about 2-3 years ago, there were a number of publications about carbon budget. So these are the emissions, and then the cumulative CO2 budget with a 50% chance of 2 degrees. Our scenarios until recently were focusing on 2 degrees. There was very little work that has been done at looking at the 1.5 degree scenario. So this is from the carbon brief that was published a few days ago. And what they're showing is what would be the carbon budget in terms of years if we were emitting at the same level of today, how many years would we have left at different temperature goals, 1.5, 2, and 3. So on the with a 50% chance of being at the 1.5, we would be at 9.8 years. At 2 degrees, we will be at 28 years, and 3 degrees, we will be at 65 years. That means that the system is completely nonlinear going from 1.5 to 3 degrees. We have 9.8 years, 28 years, and 65 years. So this shows that the efforts that are required are extremely much more important when you go to the 1.5 compared to the 2 degrees. Obviously, much more work would have to be done. IPCC is going to issue a report by 2018 looking at, hopefully, so we have a representative here of the work group 3. I think we are going to have some fun with the 1.5 degrees. So we're currently working on understanding what it means on the energy system. There is an institute in Austria which is called the IASA that has looked at the what it means in terms of carbon intensity between the IPCC assessment report 5 of below 2 degrees with 50%, which would be this part here, and the 1.5 degree scenario, which would be in this blue zone. So what it means is that the carbon intensity on a 2 degree will be zero at 2070. Here in 2000, with a 1.5, we would have to go forward by 20 years in terms of zero net emissions. So these are the kind of things that are very early. We're currently working at. Finally, and again, this is the work done by the IASA, looking at the efforts that are in terms of cost, additional cost. This is with a 2 degrees with 66% chance. And this is in terms of short-term and long-term cost between 2030 and 2100. And the different crowns here would be the percentage, 100%, 200% relative increase in cost, what it shows that going to the 1.5 is could be as much as 200% more expensive than the even the 2 degrees with 66% chance. So these are things that we would have to look at going forward, and we certainly welcome collaboration with the Imperial College and the academia to try to understand the systems. So finally, what we were showing is that going to the 15 gigatons, we would have to go to almost zero by, so that green line would have to move significantly down. So in terms, just to summarize, we have multiple signs of the world energy systems that are changing. There are strong signals from Paris, and we hopefully will see in April a significant number of countries signing. The IEA bridge scenario shows the possibility to peak the emissions in the next 5 years without impacting energy access or economic growth. The international collaboration is extremely important, so we were very pleased from the Paris, some of the announcement around the Paris Agreement, including the mission innovation for that includes about 20 countries, including the UK, and the Breakthrough Energy Coalition, which was set by the private sector to accelerate energy innovation. And then the well below 2 degree and the 1.5 that was set up by the negotiators is creating significant challenges or opportunities. And with that, I hope that it gives you good hopes for the future. I think it's a very, very exciting period going ahead. Thank you very much for your attention, and I'm looking forward to your questions.
Thank you very much. Well, that's wonderful. Thank you ever so much. And we do have time for questions. Now, we have a couple of microphones that should be in the audience. There we are. There's one there. Thank you. Thank you, Clear. Is there another one? Just one. Okay, just one. That's fine. And it's Clear's got it. Okay, good. So, questions now for Kamel. And what I'd like you to do is, if you have a question, raise your hand. And when you're picked out, tell us your name and where you come from. We are recording this, after all, and we will see what we can do to try and fit you all in. So who's got the first question? One just down here.
Thank you. I'm Heather Graven from Imperial College. I was wondering if you had specific recommendations for energy efficiency in the bridge scenario.
Okay. So we issued in October the energy efficiency market report that looked at the latest development in the energy efficiency, and we also looked at the way forward. In the for the bridge scenario, we are looking at it for different regions of the world, and every region would have a different mix. We looked at the number of policies that were involved. We are going from 14% in terms of coverage between the three sectors to 28% and now 40% by 2040. I think that every areas would be different, but what we're trying to do is also give guidelines that would be across the world. To give you an example, the SMEs, the small and medium enterprises, which in some countries represents more than 80% of the industry, we need to have specific policies to encourage those SMEs in terms of energy efficiency. We are also going to run this year a workshop for state-owned enterprises in terms of energy efficiency. How can they improve in that? And if you go to places where energy efficiency may not be the biggest the biggest priority because they have problems with energy access, I think that we can still do quite a lot. I'm going to give you an example. When I was minister in Tunisia, we had the issue of the conventional bulbs and trying to replace those conventional bulbs. For many people, actually, it was a problem buying the LEDs because of the upfront investment. So we devised a policy that actually we would give the LEDs for free. And we had something like 6 million LEDs. But what we wanted to avoid was to have people get those LEDs and then go and resell them. So we went and worked with NGOs to actually go and do the exchange of the LEDs so that they would not, I mean, they would be effectively used. In other countries, what they have done is that they have provided the LEDs and then taken the cost from future bills. So many, many different ways. But I think the most important one is that the biggest wedge in terms of peaking the emissions, 50% will come from the energy efficiency.
Thank you. And this question just in front of you. You just pass the microphone forward. Behind you.
Hello, my name is Oliver Schmidt. I'm a PhD student in the Grantham Institute at Imperial College. And in your presentation, you mentioned there will be a growth of 14 million barrels per day of oil consumption by 2040. Yeah. And I was wondering what sectors this will mostly come from and how this might relate to a possible electrification of transport and a switch in the petrochemicals industry from oil feedstock to gas-based feedstock.
Okay, so most of the increase will come from the transportation sector. And in the transportation sector, you have areas that will be, it will be difficult to electrify. The aviation sector will be quite difficult to electrify, despite our friends who are flying with solar, but I think it's going to take quite some time. So the aviation will still be very much increasing with the with time. On the transportation sector, we are starting seeing signs of electrification, or bigger electrifications. I was just recently in China, and most of the motorbikes in Beijing are actually electric. They've switched from the gasoline to electric motorbikes. So things are happening, but the problem today is that the lower oil prices are going to delay that move of the transportation.
And right in front of you as well, is the next question. We're just passing this microphone forward.
Hello, Sam.
You can't
Gill,
go anywhere after this thing.
ETNDEX, so we're a graduate of the Climate Kick, which was a partner of Imperial College. So you talked about, essentially the oil price, where it's at the moment, and the lock-in effect that might create. I mean, looking at some of the countries such as Saudi Arabia, I mean, do you believe that it's in their interest to put the price up? I mean, what's your sort of take on that? Or is strategically, is it a sort of case of get rid of as much of it as we can before regulation comes in, and therefore the OPEC essentially doing their best to suppress the price for as long as they can?
I think that the main driver is, if you look at that graph where you had the additional production, what it was showing is that between 2015 and 2020, with the older assumption of oil prices, most of the production increase would not be coming from the OPEC. It would be coming from the US, from Canada, from Brazil, but not from the OPEC. So OPEC was seeing their market share going down and down. So that was the biggest reason why they acted this way. And they thought that I think they underestimated the resiliency of the shale production in the US. Now, if you ask them if it would take until 2018 for the system to go down to a more balance, I don't think they were projecting that. They were projecting that the supply from the US would go down, and then the competition will almost shut down. So I think that it was somehow a miscalculation from their side.
So does that mean you think they have an incentive to put the price up again?
I think that, and we will see the next OPEC meeting, but you have countries that, if you look at it from, there are only three countries today that could balance their budgets at this level. It's Qatar, it is Kuwait, and it is UAE. All the other ones are suffering quite significantly.
Okay, I think we just pass it to the end. Come to, we have none from this side, so you know, get your questions ready. I'm coming to you in a minute.
Hello, I'm Diego Alonso Alvarez from Imperial College. I work in photovoltaics. I was wondering if these scenarios consider or the well any policy regarding convincing people of being themselves more energy efficient, using less energy in their daily life, changing their way of life without impacting their welfare. And well, what measures can be taken to do that, essentially?
Okay. So, I mean, we have different drivers. One is, again, it's energy access. And I started the presentation by saying that the best news was SDG 7. And today we have 1.2 billion people that don't have access to electricity. 3 billion people that don't have access to modern cooking systems. So I think the priority goes there. What we see is that those people are not going to be big consumers in terms of. The other one would increase their consumption would have to use it much more efficiently. And so the policies, whether they are on consumers or SMEs or larger enterprises or even public sites, have to be much bigger than the what we saw, the 28% of coverage. So it's a whole set of measures of energy efficiency that if I take, for instance, the EU, their objective is quite significant. 40% of being more, let's say, better in terms of energy intensity compared in 2030 compared to 1990. I think that's quite remarkable. But they are even looking further at, in 2050, to be 80 to 85% more, better, much better in terms of energy intensity. So there are all sets of measures in terms of policies that that would drive us there.
Okay, questions over this other side. Yes, you. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. My name is Brahim. I'm from Statoil, UK. First of all, I would like to thank you for your very comprehensive presentation. Well, we saw that you are expecting a very strong growth for renewables. My question is, will they continue? Have you considered that they will continue to benefit from the subsidies, or you know, they can compete with oil and other fossil fuel resources without any subsidy?
So that's a very important question, because, and it would depend on the oil prices. If we are $30, this would be depressing also the gas prices. This would also be depressing the coal prices. So the competition on the renewable would be even stronger. I think that what it means is that you look at the auction prices that we have seen. I think it was 5 cents in Egypt. It was 3 cents in Morocco. I think that they are putting us in prices that are, I mean, comparable to what we would have with fossil fuels. So we are getting to that level, but if we stay below the $30, it's difficult to justify the investment.
Thank you. There was right next to you, yes, Neil.
Neil Hurst from the Grantham Institute here at Imperial. It's a related question. One of the charts you put up showed the growth of, I think, investment in renewables. I can't remember if it's investment or capacity.
Yeah.
And particularly the PV. You saw the very, very rapid growth up to more or less today, and then it seemed to stay the same. And I just wonder, is that right that you're expecting that it will, that investment in PV will stop growing or will not grow at anything like historic rates? And if so, why would that be, considering that costs seem to be coming down very sharply?
That is related to the previous question, is that we're going to change the support mechanism for this photovoltaic. A lot of the investment that has happened in places like Spain, Italy, or going to China has been driven by incentives. Now we are going much less in terms of incentives, and so in terms of growth, we would see at the prices that we are projecting about the same level of investment in solar, going at least for the next 5 years. Yep.
Hi, it's Jim Ski, Imperial College and co-chair of IPCC Working Group 3, so I won't ask about climate change at all. It's actually about North American oil. You said in your talk that the way the US industry had adapted to lower oil prices was partly through technological change, and there's a lot of figures from the DOE that show that, you know, rig productivity has really gone up. But you also said it was because the service companies had basically taken a hit. Now, my question is, how confident are you about the attribution between these two different factors? Because obviously it makes a lot of difference to where you might project that the US industry is going to go. I mean, we had International Petroleum Week here in London a couple of weeks ago, and the divergence in the expectations between different companies was really quite large. So it's a question about confidence. You know, all forecasts and projections have proved wrong in the past, so where might they go in the future?
No, I think that we can have a reasonable level of confidence in terms of measuring what are the different components of cost decrease in developing this upstream assets. What we can say, I mean, you have different indices. One of them is very well known, is the IHS SERA cost index that measures the evolution of cost from both CapEx and OPEX for a number of projects around the world. So this gives you a level of confidence to show that there is a decrease. Now, where is that going to come from? You can also go and ask the service companies what has been the price reduction. And you see that the price reduction has been extremely important. If we continue on this trend, more than half of the fracturing companies in the US would be out of business in 2016, just because they lived with some cash reserves, but I mean they would be out. The rigs, you go to the US and you see all these dozens or even hundreds of rigs that are idle. So I think there is a significant component there. Obviously, there is the component of efficiency improvement that has happened, technology improvement. In order to frack, it used to be done some time ago, like by brute force. That means that you go and frack, and you really don't optimize things. Now you do it in a much more surgical way, where you go and frack only the zones, and with the size of the frack that is optimized. So it's a combination of that. Plus you have the efficiency improvement from a service delivery standpoint.
Time for a few last questions. Yes, one over here. Thank you, Claire. You got it.
Hi, my name is Peter Bantz, and I had a question around the difference between the numbers relating to outlooks, which I assume is what people think is likely to happen, versus the numbers to do with, you know, scenarios and temperatures and basically what we think needs to happen. And they don't seem to be compatible. You know, I've looked at this for, you know, as an amateur observer for years, and it looks like the curves to do with outlooks have kind of never-ending increases in primary energy use and never-ending increases in barrels and out to decades and decades, 2040, if I think I remember your slides. And yet what needs to happen, and I think it's most starkly represented in your 1.5 degree numbers of you need to hit zero in a decade, not 3 decades. So my question is there an incompatibility between the kind of outlook type statements and numbers of what is likely to happen versus the scenario type statements, what needs to happen, because there appears to be a yawning gap.
Thank you.
Okay. So I did the exercise of looking at at the outlooks that were done in 1990. and compared to where we are today, because 1990, we were basically looking at 2010, 2020 in terms of horizon, and compared to where we are today in terms of energy demand. And it's quite interesting that we are pretty much within 2, 3% in the same ballpark. So the curve of energy demand that we were seeing. But what we got wrong was what was below the curve. We didn't estimate the China's growth at that time. We didn't estimate the use of coal at that time. But the total energy demand was pretty much along that. I want also to caution that when we talk about the our scenarios, they are not necessarily projections, but just a set of assumptions and potential outcomes. So in terms of the relation between those outlooks and what the climate modeling, this is what is being done in the IPCC, is really trying to get as output of those the concentration of greenhouse gases and in putting them into the climate modeling. So I don't think that there is incompatibility there. And I don't know if I misread your comments, but I think that we have, obviously, within the bounds of the modeling, the input from the energy calculations. So I don't think they are incompatible.
So we don't have much more time for more questions, but that was a very interesting last question. I'm going to ask it a slightly different way. So much you might think it's an entirely different question, in fact. So if you had a clearly we need to get emissions down. And we understand that, and energy is an important component in how we do that. If you had a golden ticket or magic wand or something, you could change one thing. If you could simply change it, what would it be? What is the most important priority for us to change right now?
So I would say, and I'm not going to answer your question because I'm going to put two things. One is in terms of innovation. We need to accelerate the innovation cycle. Today, I mean, apart from organizations like IEA that are trying to do these collaboration frameworks and so on, pretty much it's every country that is doing things on their own. We looked at how much the governments were spending in public R&D in energy compared to the global budget. In 1980, 12% of the public R&D spending was in energy. 2013, it's 4%. So in percentage point, it has been divided by 3. So I think innovation is going to be a critical one. And second thing is have the policies that would encourage a faster deployment of technologies.
Thank you ever so much. The final thing to say before we wrap up is just to reaffirm the commitment that we have at Imperial College through the Grantham Institute and the Energy Futures Lab to undertake research and the translation of that research in this particular interesting area. And one of the things that's very important to us is to collect people from outside of Imperial College to come here and to listen to eminent speakers that we've had this morning so we can have an exchange and ask questions. And so we're delighted that you're all here, and thank you very much for being here. As I said, we've had this opportunity to discuss World Energy Outlook annually, and we very much look forward seeing you next year.
Thank you.
For what you can say in 12 months' time, and maybe follow up some of the questions that we've had. So please, everyone, join me for thanking to the evening speaker, Kamel Bendit. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.